think. Yeah.
Good evening. Welcome to the Robert G. McKinney Council Chamber, Tuesday, October 4th, 6:30. For the agenda is a reorganization meeting. First agenda item, Pledge Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Moving on to agenda two, election of officers. A, the chairman.
I'd like to nominate Scott Lazo.
I'll second.
There's a nomination and a second for Scott Lazo. Are there any other nominations? If there are no further nominations, nominations closed. Put it to a vote. Just call the name. Roll call vote.
Mr. Bishop.
Mr. Lazo.
Mr. Lazo.
Lazo.
Ms. Bellaquin.
Lazo.
Mr. Tomo.
Mr. Lazo.
Mr. Wang.
Mr. Lazo.
Five for Mr. Lazo.
I'd like to move on to the vice chairmanship, which the vice chairmanship has already been elected. It is Dr. Ray Page, and he will remain in the seat. Moving on to the secretary and the recording secretary, at this time, I would like to yield to the receiver to speak to the issue.
Right. I just wanted to make a note that the agenda incorrectly notes that the school committee will vote for all officers tonight. That is not correct. The vice chair, secretary, and recording clerk were elected earlier in July.
As there's no discussion on that, we'll move on to agenda number three, date, time of regular meetings. A, day of regular meetings. Any discussion?
Is it possible that we could establish the date throughout the year? I mean, we're going to do these once a month. Is that the plan?
Mr. Chairman, over the summer, it was voted that the meetings would be once a month on Tuesdays at 7 p.m.
Okay.
Would you like to set those dates?
No, that's fine. As you know, just the further we can get, maybe we could set them for next month, have the whole year done up so we can just make travel plans accordingly.
I think maybe we'll sit down with the receiver and talk about a monthly meeting, even if we chose like the first Tuesday, second Tuesday, third Tuesday, 7 o'clock. Everybody would know and lay out for the next meeting the meeting dates for the year. And then this way everybody will know when they are and we go forward with that.
We'll appreciate that. Yeah.
It would be better all the way around probably. Okay. We'll under the next regular meeting, whenever regular meeting, we'll pick a date, and then after that, we'll sit down, and the receiver will get a plan out of all the following months. The time of commencement, is there a particular time better than most? Okay, you want to keep it 7 o'clock?
7 is fine.
Okay, there's a motion for 7 o'clock, second?
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? 7 o'clock will be the time. Moving on to four, acceptance of rules of order. A, Robert's Rules of Order, newly revised. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Discussion? No discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous of all present. Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
There's a motion
second.
To adjourn and a second. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous of all present. Motion, excuse me, the meeting is adjourned. We will take a 3-minute break and allow anybody that needs to set up, and we will come back for the regularly scheduled meeting. Thank you. I'd like to welcome everybody again to the Robert G. McKinney Council Chamber, 41 Elm Street, Southbridge, Mass., Tuesday, October 4th, 2016, 7 p.m. I'd like to call the meeting to order. Roll call.
Mr. Bishop?
Present.
Ms. Duval? Mr. Lazo?
Present.
Dr. Page? Ms. Pelequin?
Present.
Mr. Thomo?
Present.
Mr. Wang?
Present.
Five present, two absent or excused.
We have a quorum. Moving on to the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Moving on to agenda item number three, public input. Is there anybody from the public that would like to address the school committee? There is nobody that wants to address the school committee. We'll move on to agenda item number four. The discussion, excuse me, July 19th, 2016, reorganizational meeting. Do I hear a motion to accept the minutes?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
There's a motion, a second. Are there any additions, corrections, or deletions to the minutes of that meeting? If not, all those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous vote, present. One abstention, Mr. Thomo. Moving on to 4B, July 19th, 2016, the regular meeting. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
A second.
There's a motion, a second. Any additions, corrections, or deletions to the minutes of that meeting? If not, all those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous vote, present.
Abstain.
One abstention, Mr. Thomo. Moving on to chairman's announcements. I was going to make it a lengthy. I had a lot to say, but I'm going to cut it short. I just want to thank everybody that supported me to the appointment of chairman. I hope I don't let you down. I work tirelessly in the limited duties that we do have, but I think that the community, we're elected by the people, for the people, and I think what we have to do is be their voice at the meetings and bring forward the things that we're hearing, the problems that need to be solved. I understand the management of the receiver is in place, and I think done properly, when parents communicate to us, so we can relay that to the receiver and work on the issues together. And I'll leave it at that tonight, and we'll move on to agenda item number six, new business. At this time, I'd like to, I noticed there's a typo here. We're going to let it go, but I think the next meeting for the design of the agenda, we are going to put the receiver's announcement so the receiver can have her time to speak to the community, along with any agenda item that is privy. But at this time, we'll go on to agenda item number six, new business, A, summer professional development, and beginning of the school year, Mr. Marinelli. Mr. Marinelli, welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Chairman Lazo and members of the school committee. Thank you for having me. Great to be here with you this evening. As Chairman Lazo mentioned, I'm going to touch briefly on three things this evening. The professional development that we offer to teachers over the course of the summer, some highlights from the start of the school year thus far, and I'll give you just a very quick snapshot of the 2016 Park and MCAS scores. We're going to be doing a lot more work with assessment moving forward, so this is just a brief snapshot this evening with much more to come. So first, summer PD, one of the things that we're really proud of is the way the school year got off to a start before the students even arrived. Beginning the week of August 15th, we had a week-long induction and orientation program for all newly hired staff. And this included, you know, many of your sort of standard fare orientation activities and introduction to technology. We're doing a lot, as Jonathan Parent will talk about later this evening, with technology. So we had a Google Boot Camp. We introduced all of our new staff to the IEP process and the software that goes along with it, some of the responsibilities that they carry as public school teachers, such as being mandated reporters, and then lots of the typical things related to their benefits and meeting the union and learning about school and district policies and procedures. The thing that I think was really exciting about this week was we had two full days of very intensive professional development for all newly hired staff, led by Research for Better Teaching, on the two high-leverage instructional strategies that are identified in our turnaround plan. Those two high-leverage instructional strategies are connected to the Massachusetts Educator Evaluation Framework. They're component 1A4, which is around developing well-structured lessons and challenging measurable objectives, and 1B1, which is about designing and administering formative assessments. So there were two full days of PD on this. We also spent a lot of time in this week working with teachers to develop their capacity to work with the population of students that we serve here. So our Director of Social and Emotional Learning, Nikki Murphy, designed a workshop on having trauma-sensitive schools and having teachers develop a better understanding of how to support students with mental illness. Because we want to improve this program moving forward and we really wanted to solicit the input of our newly hired staff, we did survey them about their experiences. We asked them whether or not they were able to take what they learned and apply it directly to their work, whether or not the content of the PD was relevant based on their grades and subject areas, whether the sessions were well organized and engaging. And as you can see, overall, on a 5-point scale, with 5 being the most desirable, on average, teachers rated their experience over the course of this week at 4.4. And in each of those sub areas I mentioned, the results were very high as well. We got a lot of testimony from teachers through our survey, so I'd just like to read one of those for you. Quote, "It was an exciting week with an extensive amount of information to absorb in a short amount of time. I loved every minute of it. Being informed of the systemic processes that are being worked on and implemented was valuable as a new employee. Feeling supported by the administration was also valuable, given that there are mixed feelings from the community about the school district being in receivership." So we really just tried to welcome people to the context and really help get their feet on the ground. Specifically related to the time with Research for Better Teaching, one teacher wrote, "I used to think I could succeed as a teacher with what I already know, coupled with my innate talent and charm, charisma, and humor. But now, I think I will continue to learn how to succeed, mostly, in the classroom, and I look forward to it." The second part of the summer PD was another week-long session that we held beginning the week of August 22nd. This is when we welcomed all staff back to the district. This was really an extraordinary event. If you talk to Dr. Heisinger about it, she'll mention that this was a team effort, but she and her phenomenal assistant, Maureen Gullickson, really deserve much of the credit for putting this together. It was chock full of really valuable experiences, I think capped off by a keynote speech by Sonia Manzano, who's a very accomplished Latina, who was also played Maria on Sesame Street, and she really gave our staff a lot to think about based about her experience contributing to what became one of the greatest contributions to public education through the Sesame Street program. The thing that was really special about this week that I think was something Southbridge teachers had never experienced before is that all of the sessions were tailored individually to the roles of the staff. So librarians had their own PD, health and wellness staff had their own PD, social and emotional learning staff, SPED staff. We had many people coming up to us after that week saying this was the first time anybody had put together a program tailored to their individual needs. We focused on lots of critical topics. I won't go into all of them here. And again, we surveyed people's responses, and it was, I think, a very valuable week. Okay, moving on to some highlights from the start of the school year. It has been busy, and I would be lying if I didn't say we're all tired, but it's off to a great start, and I just wanted to highlight a few things for you. One, there's extensive curriculum and assessment development work underway. To give you a concrete example, in elementary math, teachers are working to create new Common Core aligned units of study, rigorous common assessments that measure students' progress on the skills being taught in those units. From the common assessments, we're able to really quickly analyze data and then target the skills that students are not as proficient in so that teachers can reteach those skills immediately. This is a real paradigm shift. We've just this week administered our first assessment in grade 4, and we're in the process of administering grade 5. And while it's been hectic, it's been unbelievably valuable. So this is really exciting development. We have substantial professional development underway for teachers and administrators starting this week. All building admins and our two curriculum coordinators at the middle high school are participating in an intensive 42-hour course also led by research for better teaching called ATSR, which stands for Analyzing Teaching for Student Results. And we're going to provide ongoing professional development for our newly hired rookies and for their mentors, so their mentors are better able to support them. We are providing frequent feedback on instruction this week. All members of our central office team and our building administrators are beginning a process of doing walkthroughs in every school, which we'll do on an every other week basis. So central office administrators will pair up with the building admins. We'll do walkthroughs. We're going to evaluate instruction using a rubric we developed. We're going to debrief after that, make sure that our evaluations are calibrated, and then we're going to provide feedback back to the schools. This is a way of getting a snapshot of where we are and what we need to improve related to instruction. And lastly, or this is not by any means the last thing we're doing, but the last example, there's a lot underway to try to engineer a culture shift. So to be concrete, again, in the lower grades, that means transitioning to non-punitive responses to behavioral infractions. We're not taking away recess anymore. We're working with students and through positive interventions to try to get them their behavior back in line. There's definitely an enhanced focus on maintaining discipline and order in the middle and high school, and extensive training down the road on positive behavior, intervention and supports, and restorative justice. Yeah?
Could you go back one slide? It's not that slide. It's forward, I guess. Yeah, when you talk about to provide enhanced discipline in order, what do you mean by that? Enhanced discipline?
Well, better order in the buildings is what I mean by that. I think there was pretty much a consensus last year that behavior was a problem in the middle and high school. So there are new administrative teams in both of those buildings, and they're making sure that students are in class.
They're making well, that's good, because without discipline in the classroom, learning will suffer.
Absolutely, absolutely. There's a very strong leadership presence, both from our building administrators, but also from central office in the middle and high school. Chairman Lazo.
Mr. Marinelli, I live in Southbridge, so we hear and see everything at the markets with the people and parents, and we're hearing that the assistant principals are saying to the teachers, do not revert kids to the ISS area because of the statistics. My question on a discipline front, because I've been known to be that type of guy as a football coach and a parent of five, and what works, in what types of discipline, is it progressive? I'm hearing that there is a lack of structure as far as consequences for bad behavior. What are we doing differently if we don't have consequences? What's the alternative? What is the answer to help these kids get back online when they do something wrong?
So I definitely don't think it's that there are not consequences. I think what's happening this year is that there's just a focus on trying to prevent those behavior infractions from even happening in the very beginning by having students engaged in instruction and having a sense of order and discipline in the building. And then in cases where students are misbehaving, we're trying to get away from the kind of knee-jerk reaction of you're out of here, down to suspension or down to the principal's office, but to try to figure out what is causing the infraction and seeing if there's a way to resolve it so that the student can remain engaged in instruction. But there are consequences, and when students misbehave, they have to face those consequences. Dr. Heisengood, would you want to add anything?
Sure. Mr. Lazo, I think what the high school administration has been trying to do with the teachers is when, for example, in the past when students have been late to class, they've been told to leave. And so those kind of minor infractions, which have led to students, being tossed out of class or sent to ISS, we're really trying to get to what you're talking about, which is a progressive discipline policy, and trying to have teachers be able to manage as much of the disciplinary issues within their classrooms, because they have strong classroom management and they have strong relationships with the students. And then those more major infractions that require an ISS or an out-of-school suspension, those are saved for the more severe infractions. But our suspension rates at the high school particularly for some student subgroups, were significantly high. The number of referrals in last year, I think, exceeded 5,000. And so what we were seeing was an inordinate amount of referrals. And what I think the administration is really trying to do is work with the teachers, help them build relationships and strong classroom management, create engaging learning environments so that we're mediating those and really utilizing those more punitive discipline policies for the more severe issues. And we also are trying to put in place strong tier one social and emotional practices as part of our PBIS system, as well as restorative practices so that when there is an issue between teachers and students and students and students, that we provide them opportunities to kind of come back together and restore those relationships rather than the students being sent out, disciplined, and then brought back, and that relationship isn't really kind of restored or, you know, repaired, because that's what happens a lot with students and teachers, and then the teacher feels like, okay, you're back in my class and nothing was done. Does that make sense?
No, it makes sense. It's just that sitting on the school committee, and the reason why I ran was one of the things was this model was implemented by a former superintendent that was in our system. And what I'm concerned with, I'm cautiously optimistic. I'm standing behind whatever is going on in the system, but I'm cautiously optimistic that the students, I saw a mass exodus of the high-end learners when the classrooms were being disrupted by other children that probably needed different care or different surroundings, a different environment, or whether they need an ed plan or an alternative program. But what happened was the reaction time to taking care of the problems didn't happen fast enough, and it never happened. It created a vacuum of the high-end learners, and then the AP courses went, and the disaster happened under the previous school committee. I ran to try and support good, solid discipline, and I'm not saying the old give them the ruler and kick them out. What I'm saying is each and every child reacts differently to disciplines, and to be fair and firm, where the standard is held in a building that when they walk in, and like I work at a lot of the, like Tantasco, they have a motto when you walk in, and they all live to the motto, and it has a lot to do with behavior, because if you don't have behavior or the law and order, so to speak, in the building, you end up having chaos in the classroom. So we're all working for the same cause. Yep. It's just that I'm cautiously optimistic that leave it to the professionals at this time, and that's what I want to do, and you and Mr. Marinelli, but I'm cautiously optimistic. I know the kids of Southbridge. I coached them for 17 years, and I had the rough ones, and I had a lot of good kids. I never had a bad kid, but we had the behavioral problems, and we handled it differently on a football field than you would in a classroom, and I understand that, but I continue the workings, and what we do is we keep our ear to the ground as a school committee, and again, I will be visiting you with other issues, and we'll be working on that together. But it was an interesting concept when Mr. Thomo questioned it. I just wanted to go a little further, but I understand what you're saying and what you're doing. Thank you.
So if I could just make one more comment. You know, improving the climate and culture of Southbridge Middle and High School is going to take time. I will say, based on my 8 weeks here prior to the end of last year compared to the start of this year, the difference is significant. We are definitely on an upward trend in terms of improvements in climate and culture. I actually had a meeting with the senior class president the other day, and his comment was that this year is significantly different, a significant improvement in terms of the behavior in the hallways.
Absolutely.
The fact that the hallways are clear, kids are in classrooms. Is there still work to be done? Does that tiered systems of support need to be put into place? Absolutely. That will take time. It will take training of staff, and it will also take work with students. And that is underway at this time.
And don't misunderstand my questions, because I've heard positive things that the design of the building was middle school to the right, high school to the left. I've heard that staff has done a great job in keeping the students where they belong, in their place, where they need to be, and that the hallway discipline has been outstanding. But the class, I just am, again, cautiously optimistic. Small bites, it's a big problem, and we'll work on it. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, though.
Sure. A quick question, because Mr. Lazo touched on it. Dr. Huizinga, could you let the public know exactly where we stand with the proposed alternative school quickly? I mean, you don't have to get into it deeply, but because some people are concerned that it may not come about. I think if it does come about, and if it's done properly, it's going to benefit all students.
Absolutely, Mr. Chairman, through you. The alternative program planning is currently underway. We have hired a director of alternative schools who is currently working with a staff that we have hired for the alternative program. What we are doing at this particular time is we are in the process of planning the start of the alternative school. We are looking for a late January start. That is tentative at this particular point. They are also undergoing significant training, the staff, in order to ensure that this is a successful program. I know that we have tried alternative programming before in Southbridge, and we have not yet found a successful model. And that's why we are taking our time over the course of the next few months, and that's being overseen by our social and emotional learning director, Ms. Nikki Murphy, and she will be giving a report to the school committee on the progress of the alternative program and when it will open in the next couple months.
Thank you.
A tidbit of advice. I agree with you. Don't rush. The last alternative program that they tried was so rushed. The intent was good. Everybody was for the right reason. And then because they rushed it and they threw it together and they opened it up and they want this big thing, and then all of a sudden it was in disarray. So I'm with you. Take your time, do it right. I think that's just a tidbit of advice because I've seen this with other school committees. Thank you. Go ahead, Mr. Marino.
Mr. Martinelli, I have a question. I work for the state and we have just in the past few years started embracing PBS too. And I had a question for you on that point. One of the things that I've run into at my private workplace is that even though we receive the training, it's hard to change the culture when there's employees who have been in the system for decades. So I remember Dr. Huizenga mentioned at our last meeting that she mentioned that there might be some teachers who are slow in adopting the program. Can you give us a sense of how that's going?
Well, the work is really just beginning. And when our Director of Social and Emotional Learning, Nikki Murphy, comes to speak with you, I would ask her more about that because she is leading that work. As Dr. Huizenga mentioned, changing mindsets and changing the culture of classrooms and buildings is not something that happens overnight. So that is work that we've begun early, but we're going to continue doing over the course of this entire year. Next year, the year after next, it will be an ongoing initiative. It's not a one and done kind of PD that you do in a half day and then everybody starts interacting with students in a different way. It's also something that needs to be complemented by other structural changes to the school, to the schools and the way the schools operate that we've begun. So to be specific, the middle school this year for the first year has an advisory program to start off the day. So the way advisories work, I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, but students meet with the same teacher and that teacher on a daily basis or every several times a week. And that teacher is responsible for helping check in with the student on both the academic and the non-academic needs. And then when non-academic needs are identified, identifying the right staff, whether it's counselors or psychiatrists, psychologists, to work with that student to resolve those issues. So it's not just about the PBIS. The PBIS is one of a whole number of things related to social and emotional learning that we're working on over the course of the coming year. So. There are people who are naturally inclined to that. There are others who, as you say, have gotten used to a different system. And so that takes time and support, and we're committed to providing that to teachers.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, I'll keep moving us along here because I know some of my colleagues are also presenting. The final thing I was going to speak with you about tonight is just to provide a snapshot on the 2016 PARC and MCAS results. So as I'm sure you all know, in 2016, Southbridge students in grades 3 through 8 participated in the PARC for the first time. PARC had a math and an ELA assessment, and 10th graders continued with the MCAS assessment. And they took it in math, ELA, and science. And this year, some 9th graders also took the science MCAS. So just a quick look at the results. For grades 3 through 8 on PARC, 28% of students met or exceeded expectations on the English Language Arts assessment. If you're curious about the breakdown across the performance categories, take a look at the sub-bullets below at the percent of students who exceeded expectations, met expectations, approached, partially met, or did not yet meet. In math, 23% of grade 3 through 8 students met or exceeded expectations on the math PARC assessment. So as I mentioned, last spring was the first time PARC was administered, so if you want to compare to 2015 assessment results, bless you, you have to compare to MCAS, which is a little bit of a tricky comparison because these are different assessments with different performance categories, different cohorts of students, so it's not a simple comparison. But just to put these up here, I've broken down the 2015 MCAS results across the elementary schools, and I've just picked one of the grades in the middle school, seventh grade. And as you can see here, Charlton Street School, 42% of students scored proficient or advanced on the 2015 ELA MCAS. 33% scored proficient or advanced on the ELA MCAS at the West Street School in 2015. 31% proficient or advanced on ELA in grade 7. So by comparison, the PARC scores are a little bit lower on average, but this is a new assessment. It's a more rigorous assessment. It's not a surprise that the PARC scores are a little bit lower on average than the comparable MCAS scores. Mr. Bishop.
Dr. Marinelli, I see it as a significant downward trend, but again, it is a much more challenging test. What is the state average? How did that compare? Do you know off the top of your head?
I don't know that off the top of my head, but I will have that for you when we talk about these results in greater depth. And I'd be happy to follow up with you about that. If you have any questions coming out of this presentation, please don't hesitate to contact me. I'd be happy to follow up. The math results you can see here are also on average lower, but again, this is a different assessment, so it's not a trend per se as much as it is a different average level of performance. So looking at the 2016 grade 10 MCAS scores, 78% of 10th graders scored proficient or above on the ELA MCAS. 37% scored proficient or above on the math grade 10 MCAS, and the same percentage on the science grade 10 MCAS. If you compare those 2016 scores to 2015 scores, you will see that the scores are comparable across the year, across the 2 years, 1 point higher in ELA, several points lower in math and science. So again, this is just a snapshot. You can break these scores down by student subgroup, by grade, by subject. We can look at trends over time. We can compare to state averages. We can compare to other districts in the state that you'd like to see the results compared by. We will be talking a lot more about the data, and Mr. Bishop has already been in communication with some results he's interested in seeing. If others have interest, please contact me. Thank you.
Could I ask you one fast question?
You sure can.
High school this year coming up in 17, will they be doing MCAS or PAC?
They will be doing next-gen MCAS.
Next-gen, so they're ready to roll that out? The state is?
Oh, Dr. Heisinger.
No, the state is not ready to roll that out.
Sorry, I may have given you a misinformation.
Did you ask about 10th grade?
Yeah, 10th grade. Are they going to be doing MCAS, PAC, or?
10th grade will be doing MCAS until 2020.
2020. Okay, thank you.
10th grade, sorry, I misheard your question. Right, 10th grade because they've been doing MCAS and they need to follow the percentages for their high school diploma stays with the same assessment. Sorry.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Moving on to agenda item 6C. Budget update, Mr. Deedy.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good evening, everyone. just very quickly, in the packet that I left at your desk this evening, number one, there is a 50-page budget report. I apologize. I wasn't sure if you wanted detail or not. I seek your direction for the future. We can run those reports in detail or in summary. I defer to you on that. And I'm happy to answer questions about that later on. Secondly, there was a request from a committee member last week, and I provide you with a response to that. Thirdly, you've got a quick grant update from me on a couple of new grants that we received this year as part of the receivership. Number four, just a quick update on Breakfast in the Classroom, which is a new program this year that is being funded, supported through two competitive grants. Number five, something I added new to the agenda this year, and I'd like to keep it as an ongoing agenda item, just a quick update on operations and maintenance of our buildings from our facility director. And then number six, just two quick updates on the bus contract and the MASBO financial review. That being said, what I've also included too, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, is a brief executive summary of each item here. So that being said, I'm going to start with item number one, which is the year-to-date budget report, which I ran earlier today. And again, as I noted, it's actually 48 pages long. So again, and I gave that to you earlier this evening. So without going into the report in detail, just a couple of highlights I wish to share with you. Number one, that a majority of the salary budget line items have been fully encumbered. Number two, a majority of the expense budget line items have been fully encumbered. We still need to make some adjustments in the salary budget between the operating budget and several of the new grants that came in, and so we'll be doing those adjustments in the next week or two. Number two, another item that I saw as I begin to live the operating budget is that there needs to be a further reclassification of the expenditures. And I use that as an example, for example, in the superintendent's budget, the 1200 series accounts. There's one line item for professional development and other expenses, which is the same line item that's used by curriculum, finance, and human resources. I would propose, and again, this would align with the expenditure categories in the end of the year report, that same classification of expenditures be applied, for example, to business and finance, to curriculum, to human resources as well. Because at the end of the day, it's misrepresenting the actual cost. We may be classifying those expenses to the superintendent's line. Again, just staying with that one example, when in reality, if we're spending $10,000, it might be $2,000 for the superintendent, $2,000 for the business administrator, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So as I went through the budget, and again, there are other areas, the athletic budget, for example. Again, there are two or three budget line items. What I didn't see, which I think should be there, should be a separate line for contracted services, a separate line for dues and professional obligations. And again, I'm just speaking from my past practice and how I would classify expenditures. And again, I think it just gives better clarity, more transparency as to how we're expending these dollars. So I haven't made these changes yet. I need to work with the town accountant to restructure these, but certainly moving forward into the FY18 budget process, these are items that I'll bring to your attention as we build the FY18 budget process. If I may, Mr. Chair, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Bill.
Thank you. Mr. Deedy, it's been maybe 30 years since I've looked at one of these from the last time I was on the school committee. So I got to familiarize myself with this. Maybe you can answer a quick question. The unemployment cost so far, do you have a number on that?
I do. So through the chair, if I may, Mr. Chair, I'm just going to jump down to item number two because that was a requested item. And in my narrative, I do direct you to that information, which is on page 46 of the budget report, but the expenditure to date, and this is through warrant 13, in essence through the month of August, is $153,252.13. of a $200,000 line item in the budget.
Do you expect that to go up during the course of the year or the first semester of the year?
So through the chair, we did do some projections, and the projections were based upon the August figures. And again, it's my role to anticipate a worst case scenario, knowing that those numbers will probably be reduced as we move forward. But I did project approximately $387,000 above the appropriation. However, that is worst case scenario.
Right.
Secondly, and again, we should be receiving the September invoice probably another week or so. We'll have a better sense as to where we stand. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
You can never shut me up once I get going.
No, I only ask that because this is the first full year of state receivership, and there's going to be people leaving on their own. There's going to be people leaving because they're going to be asked to leave because they're not doing a job. And that's the reason why I'm wondering if you have a higher amount budgeted in case that happens.
So through the chair, the budget line item is the budget that we began the fiscal year with. What we'll need to do is obviously as we proceed through the year, we will need to do line item transfers that I'll bring forward to the receiver. And those dollars will come from either the salary or the expense budget to backfill what is going to be a shortfall in that line.
I just don't want books to be affected or instructional items. And thank you.
Through the chair, understood.
Through the chair, Mr. Deedy. I did go to see Mr. Deedy this past week regarding unemployment and legal costs. Those are two concerns that I had when I ran for this office. I don't want to misquote what you said. Did you say that you were projecting $380,000 above what was already budgeted?
Through the chair, $387,000. Worst case scenario.
So we're still looking at $500,000 or more.
Through the chair, probably a little bit less than $500,000. Okay. Again, have a better sense when the September numbers come out.
Right.
And we are monitoring this line very closely, looking at who on that current report may be employed. Number two, who has filed for benefits and who may not be entitled to benefits depending upon the filing.
Okay. On a positive note, I did ask Mr. Deedy for the legal bills up to this date, and I was happy that they had budgeted $250,000, which I questioned back in July. I'm happy to say we've only expended roughly $15,000 of that, so at least we're not going a quarter every time, so that's a good thing. Thank you. Thank you for your quick work in getting me that information.
Just a quick comment, Dan, and to the receiver. You have to understand that our community is fragile as far as this is the next group coming in to save us. We had a gentleman, Buzz Nembakawa, came in. The unemployment went up. They said, well, we had to clean house, and they did. And what we created was a lot of cost overruns and a lot of the budget items and blew up the budget. Then we had another lady come in and same thing, have to put my people, clean this up, do this, we're gonna do it. More unemployment, more problems, the revolving door continued. Then we had a third superintendent, and then we go into receivership. And again, I'm cautiously optimistic because I'm sitting here as a citizen, and now I'm on the committee, I'm no longer just the citizen. And the best teacher I have is history and government, and the history is not good. And there are overtones right now that I am cautiously optimistic, but I'm worried. And one of them is the unemployment, which I know the town manager's statement at one of the subcommittees was, we're helping you out this year, but there is no more money next year. And with that in the back of my mind, politically, it tells me that, you know, the council faucet is, I don't know if it's still on. It sounds like it was shut off for future needs. And I think, even if we're doing the right thing in what we're doing, the dollars have to balance in the end. And again, I have a lot of respect for you. I think you're a very strong finance director, probably stronger than most that I know and met. And I tip my hat to you that you know what you're doing. But again, cautiously optimistic, full steam ahead. We're here, but it's a scary number. To look at. It's the first time I heard it, so I just wanted to float that out there. Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you.
You have the floor,
Dan. Secondly, to the request of committee member Bishop, again, the second question raised was the legal fees. And again, that number is identified on page 2 of the budget report, $15,174.47. And through the chair, I wasn't sure, again, as I wrote my narrative, I was referencing DESE function codes and object codes, and I made an assumption in there. And so I also included at your desk this evening an 8-page document, which is the chart of accounts that we use. And I just thought that would be helpful so that as I use this terminology in my narratives or in my discussion, not do you need to flip back to it tonight, but I'm going to make an assumption that you've probably heard of that before, but you probably haven't seen it. So now you got it in blazing black and white copy paper. So, and I'm happy to answer any questions about that that you may have.
Dan, just a quick comment on something that you mentioned about detailing the budget with more transparency, you know, like dues and the athletic budget and stuff. I just got on the school committee a year ago, and I was shocked at the way it was, because back in the day, that was a common practice, what you were talking about when we had finance directors, splitting up the accounts where you actually see where the money goes, and it's an open, honest budget. And when you go to the council and when you have to deal with the appropriation, that type of finance director works a lot better with the town side than what we've had. So I think you're right on time on that.
And through the chair, thank you. And what I'm looking to do, again, is align our expenditures with the end of the year report. Specifically, I'm looking to align our expenditures with Schedule 3 of the end of the year report. And again, I'm going to make an assumption. We've got several veteran members here on the committee, but Schedule 3 are the 2000 series expenditures for the buildings, so the middle school, high school, the elementary schools. And again, as you go through the end of the year report, Schedule 3, you'll see the delineation in no uncertain terms of those expenditures. And I'm not seeing that now, so I can't really fix that yet for this year, but it's on my to-it list, if you will. And certainly, as we move forward in preparation for the FY18 budget, you will see those shifting of costs and the greater delineation of the expenditures.
Any questions, Mr. Bishop?
Yeah, I'd like to move past that. I'd like to go to the FY17 grant, three-quarters of $1 million.
Sure.
That's pretty nice. Did that come from DESE, or where
yes,
did that
is.
Fall from?
So, through the chair, as part of the receivership, we have received two grants with a total of approximately $750,000. The first grant, in my world, I call it the 323 fund code, which has a value of $615,000. And then the second grant, which is a state grant with a value, fund code 220, with a value of approximately $135,000. The 220 grant is a state grant, as I said, and it runs through June 30 of 2017. The 323 grant, and again, I do speak about this in my brief narrative, is a federal grant. And that grant runs through August 31st of 2017. And primarily, these grants are being used to support professional development with instruction. We did use a portion of the funding in the 323 grant to support the beginning of school, as Dr. Marinell spoke about earlier. The first 3 days were funded through that grant there. Again, the total value is approximately $750,000, and we do anticipate very strongly that these dollars will be available again in FY18.
Great. Thank you.
So that was my quick update on item number three. Moving to item number four, something new in the district this year. Back in late July, early August, we applied for a competitive grant through the American Association of School Administrators for $10,000, up to $10,000. We wrote a grant for approximately $9,700 and change, and we did receive this grant. That gave us the additional $300 of $10,000. And when we were looking to kick off the Breakfast in the Classroom program, as part of the grant, we were looking at one building, West Street School. Concurrently, we also received another grant through the EOS Foundation, and the $12,000 is actually a two-year award. And those dollars are being used primarily to support the activity, Breakfast in the Classroom at the middle school. And as we move forward, there is another grant, another competitive grant that we're looking to submit an application for. And certainly we're looking to expand the program after the holidays to another building. And I think it's important to note, as I wrote in my narrative, that the middle school, there's an 80% participation rate in these numbers as of the week ending September 23rd, so they're just hot off the press, so to speak. And over at West Street School, with the exception of three days, we're looking at 90% participation rate, which I think is phenomenal in the buildings. And as we discussed this as a team and looked at the successes that this program has generated, I tip my cap to the teachers who have done tremendous work with the students in advocating and communicating the benefits and the merits of this program.
If I could, Mr. Chairman, through you, I just want to give the committee some context in terms of the impact this program has made. Last year at the West Street School, our breakfast participation rate was 32%. And we're looking at right now with the Breakfast in the Classroom program, our participation rate has been 90%. So we know that 90% of our children are actually getting nutrition and food upon coming to school. So that's an incredible increase.
Through you, Mr. Chair. Dr. Heisinger, how has it been logistically? Has it impacted? I mean, you just
In fact, the teachers are raving about the program, and at the middle school, it's had a significant impact because we no longer have middle schoolers and high schoolers in the cafeteria together in the morning. So students are coming in and going right to their advisory, and they're actually having a small community breakfast as a part of their advisory and really building strong relationships amongst the students, but also between the students and the teachers in that setting.
That's terrific. Thank you.
The next item, and just very quickly, I included in your packet an update that our facility director has prepared for me. This is an item that I shared with my previous school committee just to keep them apprised of the happenings in the buildings, any projects that operations and maintenance are about, any potential issues on the horizons. Is there a hot water heater that might be ready to go in another building? So just to keep you apprised of those. What could be, we speak about unemployment, but some of these operational costs, if we do have a boiler problem or a problem with a water heater, we're looking at potentially, $15,000 to $20,000 for a water heater and a boiler. The sky could be the limit. So that's just something I'd like to keep you apprised of as we move forward.
Dan, just another question. We used to, back in the day, as they say, when you had a boiler breakdown, it was a capital improvement. It really was an education dollars, and it was very easy to go back to the town for something unfortunate or unpredictable. Are we splitting our dollars where capital is separate? Because a lot of times we had different town managers, and one town manager would say, this is what you're getting in your budget, and that's it. Then we had Florence Chandler, who liked to put building maintenance and like roofs and stuff like that. She used to give us so much money per year for capital improvements. I'm not sure where the manager and yourself, I haven't been, in to talk about that. But
through the chair, for this year's operating budget, there is a separate line item of approximately $300,000 called capital funds, which are being used to support the operating budget. The delineation of these funds are sevenfold, if you will. There's approximately $114,000 even dedicated to textbooks. And then the balance of the funds, there's also approximately $20,000 even dedicated to purchasing equipment, floor sanders for operations and maintenance. And then the balance is approximately $66,000 even for instructional technology and then for instructional hardware and software. The $66,000 line, as Mr. Parent will speak about in a few minutes, we're using that line to offset our E-rate program. Our E-rate application has been approved, and we're looking at an obligation there of approximately $15,000. We did use that instructional technology line, as I had stated earlier in the summer, for the short-term float the procurement of the Chromebooks on the premise that we would receive the additional cash or an additional allocation once free cash was certified by the town.
Do they have a description of, for the public, what is capital? Back in the day, they used to turn around and say, well, anything that costs over a certain amount of money or have a life expectancy of certain much was described as capital, which held us kind of accountable to the council and the town side that we both understood what capital was, because some people get a little wishy-washy with capital money.
Through the chair, the 32nd definition of capital, single item with a value of $5,000 or more with a life expectancy of 8 years or greater.
Thank you.
That's a 32nd definition.
Good job. Any other questions?
Last item, just want to make you aware, the bus contract is up this year. And it's my intention to put it out to bid probably early to mid-November, maybe late November at the latest, so that we can get a good number as we move forward with the FY18 budget process. And last but not least, I have pretty much finished the review of the MASBO financial review, and I'll have that for you at our next meeting, and probably dedicate that meeting, Mr. Chair, to reviewing that with the committee. You know, we'll get it out to you in advance, and we'll go through the salient points of the review to share with you and with the public.
Any other
Thank
questions?
You, Mr. Chair. That completes my report.
The only thing I would say, Mr. Chair, I don't know if we need this whole 48-page report every month. I mean, I'm not into cutting trees down. If anybody has, I think if we can all take a trip up to the high school, and Mr. Deedy's more than happy to. That would be my recommendation. I mean, if anybody, I don't know if we have to vote on that or whatever, but I don't think I need a 48-page report every month.
Again, what is the flavor of the day for the committee, and what are they looking for in a budget update? There are all different types of approaches. We've seen them over the years. Kill them with paperwork, or just highlight the earth-shaking moves as we go through underneath a finance report, so to speak.
Well, through the chair, just a couple of suggestions. Again, as I mentioned earlier in my report, I can run a report and just do totals, again, using the DESI function code, 2000 series, 3000 series, et cetera. That could be a 1 to 2 page report, and you're going to see it at 50,000 feet if you want that. Secondly, I do want to give you probably quarterly updates on our revolving funds. What I didn't give you this evening, but I will next time, is a trial balance report to share with you. I'm not sure you've seen those at all. And there's some old funds that are sitting dormant. And I have worked with the town accountant, just as an example. We had the Yellow School Bus Grant that's sitting as a balance there going back to 2009. It's not a lot of money. It's $200 each. But there were four or five schools going back to 2009 and we've expended those dollars. I met with the town accountant, we got them off the books this year. The state doesn't want that money back. There are some old dormant gift accounts. The problem with the gift account, as you know, is that you can expend from that account for the purpose of which the account was created, so they're very tight. So that's going to require some homework in terms of how those accounts were created. But then again, I was speaking with the principal at Eastwood Road School, and she had a need for some kindergarten materials. And I said, well, the trial balance report that I sent you back in the end of August showed a balance of $600 in this kindergarten account. Why not spend it? Why have it sit there? Get it off the books. So again, I could probably talk all night, but I think you want to get out of here by midnight.
Dan, why don't we do this? Why don't we have a sit down and with the receiver? I mean, I know we do not do budget. I understand that role. I think that what we have to talk about is the approach for the community to understand what we're doing at the same time that the committee can understand as we go through the year. So we'll have a sit down at the office, and we'll come back with a layout of how to present these things so the community knows their tax dollars are being used properly and where it's going. We can do this together, but we'll have a sit down.
Happy to do that. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Any other questions? If not, moving on to D, technology, Mr. Parent.
Thank you for having me. Congratulations, Mr. Chair.
You have 30 seconds.
So I will not keep you here as long as Dan. My presentation hopefully is a little more upbeat as well. A lot of exciting things have been happening the last few months in the technology department. One thing I might add, one thing that Southbridge Public Schools did not prepare me for was public speaking, so I'm going to have to work on that at the high school. So we've had some exciting changes over the past 5 months since I've started. Well, let me back up. When I met with you guys last time, I talked about a lot of things that were wrong. In fact, I think I used the word neglect when I talked about the technology department. And while it's not as interesting, doesn't usually get as much attention as instruction, it's definitely important, especially in the 21st century. So I identified very quickly a bunch of items that I could fix, not only to improve the district, but also save us some money. So the first thing I worked on was the website. I took us from a very bleak looking website to a very modern looking website, one that can be updated easily, one that does not require 10 steps between the getting of information and getting it to the website. An example of that would be the food service menus that get posted every week. Instead of having someone type up the menu, who prints it out, who faxes it over, who then takes it and rewrites it, the person that's originally typing the food service menu is actually editing the website directly. That's just one example of many things. We're integrating calendars, alerts, many different things. Like I said, it looks much more modern. Flexibility with the updating is critical. You know, I don't have a ton of staff in my department. And what we moved to, and this was the biggest motivator for me, was it's much more cost effective. We went from $10,000 a year in web hosting costs to $300. That's $10,000 a year that was not being spent in the classroom, $10,000 a year that wasn't being spent to hire a qualified teacher. So it's just tremendous savings, and it was a no-brainer. Email, another thing that we switched for this summer. We switched from Office 365, which the district has had for the past 5 years, to Google Apps for Education. Some of the big reasons why we switched was it has seamless integration with all the Chromebooks that we've recently purchased. It has unlimited capacity. Nobody has any reason to run out of storage. You have as much space as you want. And again, cost effective. We were paying about $6,000 a year for additional services for our Office 365. Now we're paying nothing for our email. The other secondary benefit of getting off Office 365 is, and switching to Google, is we're using the free Google services more, which means we're not reliant on Microsoft software anymore. So again, that's saving us $27,000 a year in recurring Microsoft software costs. Classroom technology. Classroom technology was in a sorry state, if it existed at all. It's my representation of an old computer and nothing. The elementary schools in particular had very little technology. We finished today, as a matter of fact, our delivery of 1,300 Chromebooks in the district, ranging from the Chromebook notebooks on the left-hand side that you see and the desktops on the right. The benefits of using Chromebooks is they're very intuitive to use, very easy. They maximize instructional time. One of the big things that I mentioned last time was when I saw when we were walking around and we were seeing classes try to use the existing technology, laptop carts, for example, they would be wasting 15, 20 minutes of classroom time trying to find a computer that worked. So they were getting nothing done. Students were getting nothing done. And they're much more cost effective. Instead of spending upwards of $700 or more for a PC, we're spending about $200 per device. Other initiatives I have going on. One of the big frustrations I had when I started was I couldn't get into any of the infrastructure equipment district-wide. So that has been accomplished. I've broken into everything, which is making me sleep a little better at night because I don't have to worry about a call from someone in the middle of the night and me not being able to react to it. There is no money in my budget for this year for dedicated tech integration support for teachers. So we came up with the next best thing, which we created several stipend positions using existing teachers to be tech leaders. So tech leaders are people that provide additional PD every month. They meet with me, we brainstorm ideas, things that their building needs, and they go back and run voluntary PDs, an hour PD each month for their building. They serve as a point person, they serve as the tech cheerleader for their building, something that hasn't existed in the past. Like Mr. Didi said, our E-Rate money was actually approved today as well. I'm not making all this up. All this stuff happened today. So what we're trying to do is do a complete wireless overhaul of the district, specifically in the elementary schools. The elementary schools were in a sorry state for Wi-Fi. It was non-existent. So we're adding about 100 access points district-wide. Another thing that's in progress is we're going to start a student help desk. And that's going to help us twofold. One, it's going to create a career path for students. They're going to be able to leave, and if they don't, if they're not college ready, if they just decide they don't want to go to college, they're going to be able to be hired instantly. They're going to have certifications. They're going to have the experience necessary to jump into a tech field. And two, it's going to help us. We can't keep spending. I hate spending money on administrative costs, administrative overhead costs. So I don't want to fill the district with a bunch of technicians. So they're going to help. And three, the most important thing is. I want teachers to see what their students are capable of. I want teachers to be getting help, being able to come to a student and say, I need your help with this, and sort of have the tables turned in that regard. And that is it, if you can believe it.
Any questions?
Any questions? Yes.
When will the elementary schools have Wi-Fi?
I can't hear you.
Will the elementary schools have Wi-Fi?
So, like I said, the E-Rate money, which is our federal grant money to get our wireless access points, we put in the application in May. It was supposed to be approved in July, and it was just approved today. So, I'm working with Dan, we're working with Karen in the town accountant to get the PO processed as soon as possible. It's one of my number one priorities, so.
Okay.
As soon as possible.
Thanks.
Go.
Yes.
I have a question about the website. I don't know if this is in your wheelhouse, but I know that we used to post the school committee meeting minutes online, but I haven't been able to find any for this session. So are we still doing that? Or?
Yep, definitely. There's a whole school committee section on the website. If there aren't any recent meetings, I'll certainly work with the town to get those posted for you.
Okay, all right, yeah. Thank you.
Any other discussion? If not, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Moving on to determining the next regularly scheduled school committee meeting date. The first Tuesday would be November 1st, and the second would be the 8th. What is the choice?
Well, Mr. Chair, the 8th is election day, so I imagine this place will be buzzing. The town hall will be busy, so I would recommend the 1st.
So motion for the 1st. Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Next meeting is Tuesday, November 1st. Moving on to 7.
Is that, hold on. We have the MASC conference, that's November 2nd through the... Yeah, we can still do that. Yeah.
All set?
Yeah, okay.
Moving on to number 7, members forum. Members have anything to say at this time?
Yeah, I just have a question for Dr. Heisinger. Last year, after the MCAS scores were released by the commissioner, he sent a team out from Malden to give us a presentation on the results and beat us up quite a bit. And I was wondering if Mr. Curtin will be back to give us another overview of where we stand and where we should be standing.
Okay. So Mr. Curtin will not be conducting that presentation, but Dr. Marinow will. And that presentation will be coming up, I believe, in the next meeting, November? Yes, so he's going to be doing the similar presentation that Mr. Curtin did, but we'll be doing it in-house.
Great. Thank you.
Mr. Lazo?
Yes, Mr.
Question. Rules, regulations, you went over that the first week of school, according to the, who spoke up here, rules, regulations?
What, the handbook?
Yeah, the handbook. Well, that's my question. Are teachers getting handbooks? They will be getting them? Okay, good.
They've gotten them.
They have?
Yes.
Great.
In past years, that has been a very slow problem in the district, and when we ran, it was very important to get the handbooks out so the parents would understand. That's, I assume that they went out after we conquered that problem and just, you know, continue to do it.
Mr. Chair, through you, I believe the student, are you speaking of the student handbooks?
Yes.
Student handbooks are all online. They're on our website.
And teachers have access to that?
Yes.
So they'll see what's going to happen regarding grades, unexcused absences. They'll know.
All student handbooks are online, and all students got them at the beginning of the year.
Okay, great.
Any other discussion, Mr. Bishop?
Yeah, I have one thing I wanted to mention. I just want to compliment Dr. Heisinger on the team she's assembled to run our schools during this receivership period. I've had the opportunity to interact with Mr. Didi, Dr. Marinelli, as well as Mr. Parent. Everybody has been super responsive, super knowledgeable on what they're doing, and forthcoming. They're not trying to hide anything under the rug. So when I ask a question, I do appreciate the fast, speedy, accurate answers. So great job on getting these great people to come help us. Thank you.
And real quick, we're going to be in the, she's probably going to get mad for me for saying this, but we're losing a longtime employee from the food service department who's going to be retiring, I think, Tuesday, Shirley Anker. I hope she's recognized or thanked for all her years of great service to our system.
Any other discussion? If no further discussion, moving on to 8, adjournment. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Is a motion and a second? All those in favor? Opposed? We're adjourned.